following interview is part two of an interview with Mary Louise Foster for the Purdue University Library Oral History Program. It took place on Wednesday, October the 12th, 2006, at her office in Matthews Hall. This is the continuation. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. I want to ask you a couple things about the, does the department ever have an internship program? At all to the school or the theater department? Did they have it? Tell us a little bit about that.
The CSR department, each of the majors in that department have their has an internship, you know, related to their major topics, and they vary from credit hours of 1 hour to 3 hours. The different ones have different requirements. It's all 140 hours of work for each hour of credit, and it is a requirement for every student in CSR.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. You talked about the student ambassadors, and that's kind of an active thing, isn't
yes,
it? That's
yes.
really been going quite a while. And then one of the programs that I read about was a student chapter of Society of Consumer Affairs Professionalism, and they had some tie-in with the Fight Back Foundation, which was formed in 1991. Is that still going? Or?
Yes. Dr. Widdows is our department chairman, and he was very active in that when it first started as a student organization, and he was here formerly as a staff member. He was away a while, now he's back as a department head, and they're still active in it. And he has recently gone to a convention and was saying, when I was telling him about the interviews that we were having, he was saying, well, he knows how it is to be first on the line of doing things and the oldest one in the organization. Because they had been coming to him about the organization as both as a student and as a professional organization.
Okay. What exactly?
It's still going.
It's still going. What sort of, is there a chapter here?
There's a chapter here,
yeah.
And the kinds of things that they do, I was participating in the national programs, and it's a small group, but it's still viable.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Tell us a little bit about your career as a faculty member and then how it has changed somewhat since you've retired.
Well, I started out, you know, as a teaching assistant in the home management house when I was doing my master's, and then taught high school home economics in addition to completing my master's, and working with student teachers. I think I have told you before that I thoroughly enjoyed working with student teachers at Delphi High School, and didn't want to give that up to come to the university when they asked me to come back to work in the home management houses. Then I finally got smart and thought, well, I can work with all student teachers if I come back, because at that time the main a part of the home management program was working with the education department of home economics, and so I was a house advisor and supervised the graduate students and taught the course from 54 to 83, something like that, when we closed the home management houses, and we, for a time, taught the course over in Stonehall as a laboratory course, and then when it became time for me to retire in 87, after we had closed the home management houses, I had been an academic advisor in the main school office, and so I was out of work about probably a month. And Dr. Feinberg, at that time, was the department head in CSR, and he was too busy to do the advising of the students that were assigned to him, and he asked me if I would do it, because I was retired from advising for the school. So I did that. Other professors discovered that Dr. Feinberg was freeing up some of his time by not having to advise students, and so they said, "Will you do my students?" Well, as it turned out, I got to advising all those students in CSR. And at that time, we developed a peer advising program where I worked with 7 or 8 students, juniors and seniors usually, and supervised them while they were advising students and registering students and helping them work out problems. So that was an interesting part. I really enjoyed working with peer advisors, and I still hear from them as they have gone through their careers and married and had families, and I still keep in touch with that group of students. Then as the department grew and one person couldn't take care of all the advising, and they hired because I really wasn't hired as an academic advisor, I was just a part-time helper that was working pretty much full-time, which was my choice. I thoroughly enjoyed working with students, because in the home management houses, all my teaching experience had been working with small groups, and to me that was the best way of reaching students, was one-on-one kinds of thing. So that's the reason I've always enjoyed advising, and the reason I have continued doing so even into my retirement. We now have a full-time academic advisor, and 3 or 4 of us in the school assist, because it's even too much. The department has grown to beyond one advisor doing it all by themselves.
Could you back off a little bit? On the home management house, you state you lived in there.
You lived in the house.
Okay. Uh-huh. And then was there a faculty person or in each of the houses?
There would be a graduate student.
A graduate student.
Home management graduate student. Home management, family economics.
But would you just be over the one house?
I'd be over the one house, and also coordinated the graduate students so that all the three other houses were operated in the same fashion. Yes, we always had it. Of course, that was a requirement to have a faculty person or an adult
in the house,
living with the students.
Mm-hmm. And what was the nature of the lab course that was this in Stone Hall? What sort of work?
We tried to follow very much the same pattern as in the home management house, except they weren't living there, but they had the same kinds of experiences of planning meals and buying the food and the cleaning process and teaching the laboratory and having social activities. We would invite people for lunches or teas or on some other kinds of activity. And then in addition to that, because we weren't fulfilling all the mission of the course, we started working out in the community, like at schools. We might be working with schools that had students that needed assistance in taking care of them, their health and their grooming, that kind of thing. Wabash Center. We taught classes at Wabash Center where they work with handicapped students. Mm-hmm. And
is that still going on? Do they still do that?
No, we do not do that now through the department. I'm sure other parts of the college have activities at Wabash, but as far as mm-hmm. consumer science and retailing, we don't.
We don't do it. Okay. You certainly served under several department heads, haven't you?
Yes.
And also heads of the school. How has that affected changing the school?
Starting with as an undergraduate and in my first years of teaching, Dean Matthews was a professor and the dean of the school, and then I've worked under every dean since, of course.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
And then when I was in Brazil, Dean Vale was the dean of the school, and she was assisting there and was visiting in Brazil at the school of Sousa when I arrived. So it was an interesting time because I'd worked with Dean Vale here on campus, and then in Brazil she was the dean of the school at the time we were working down there.
That's where my next thing is. Tell us a little bit about Brazil and how you happened to go there. And
well, that almost stems from the home management experience also. There had been no home economics. Well, of course, Purdue was helping organize land-grant college after the Purdue pattern. Since 1952, when some extension people, an agent and a home economist and an ag agent, were the people that started it.
Whereabouts in South America is this?
In the state of Minas Gerais, in the interior of, in the mining state. And it's very much interior. It was two mountain ranges in and working in the third mountain range. So it was very far from Rio in distance and climate and so forth. It was very...
What was your impression
unique,
the first time you saw it when you arrived there?
Very experience. Well, of course, I was pretty well schooled on what was going on there because back to how I happened to go, I was a home management house advisor when Cordell Hamilton, one of the home economists in Brazil, was home on home leave, and she was not much to my dismay. I had no idea this was in the works. Was hunting somebody to recommend to go down to take her place and to add one more home economist on the staff there. From Purdue, so they asked me to invite the steering committee for the Vasosa project, the professors here on campus, to the home management houses for lunch. So all the various home management houses had two or three people for lunch, and I was of course one of the advisors, and so I had no idea they were interviewing me to go to Brazil. So when that offer came, I was surprised, but I of course knew very much about it because we had worked with Dr. Hamilton and knew what was going on in the project there. What they needed was the home economist that was in the home management professor, consumer economics professor from Purdue, was getting ready to leave, and her time she had fulfilled all the time she could spend there, and they were needing somebody to go and develop a home management program, like a home management house, because they didn't have a laboratory. And of course it was very difficult to do that kind of thing. It was not their culture to for the student and the young woman to operate her own house, because she had maids and servants that did the laundry and did the food shopping and took care of the children and so forth. So it was a challenge to develop something so new, but Brazilians were very open to what Purdue had to suggest, and so they were very much ready to make over what had been a storage shed for the gardening equipment and the horticulture gardens to make us a temporary home management house. Now, the students didn't live in. This was located adjacent to the first woman's dormitory that had ever been devised and built and put into operation in Brazil. Purdue, of course, took their residence hall ideas along with them. So we had the women's residence hall, and the students lived there at night, but they would come to the home management house and prepare the meals and do the laundry, which most of them had never done any laundry because they had somebody do the laundry for them. So it was a very interesting experience. Made many friends, didn't want to leave.
Was your contract, did you have to be there for a certain period of time?
You had to be two tours, they would call it.
And what would be the length?
Two years.
So you would be there originally for 2 years, and then you could get a renewal?
Yes. Uh-huh,
okay.
And I was the last home economist on the job, and they let me stay an extra year because they were closing out the Purdue part of the contract. And when the Purdue contract started at the home economics school, there were just two home economists from Purdue, and then they had a few more years, they had four. But in the meantime, the wives of the agriculture professors that were there in the with their families would help do the teaching, because there were no reservoir of teachers to draw from, because there weren't any others in Brazil. And so there were 40 at the time I was there in the 60s. There were 40 Purdue families there, and so we had quite a few willing volunteer professors, to ladies with experience of homemaking, to help us teach all the home economics subjects until we could get the first class graduated and send them to Purdue for their master's degrees, and they came back and started teaching. Well, in the last few, I never did teach Portuguese in the class. I operated the class and working with the professors more or less like a student teacher. We would work out the lesson, because she would know some English, I would know a little Portuguese, and then she, the new teacher, the student would, because she'd been to Purdue and, you know, had that much English, but she would teach in Portuguese. I would sit in the room and could understand enough of it, and we would converse back and forth, and we'd refer to each other, and we would teach together, but she had the main teaching responsibility in Portuguese, because the students, of course, didn't know any English. And it was very difficult to learn Portuguese, because the students on campus, when you were with them, and the professors also, wanted to practice their English on us, so it was very hard for us to practice our Portuguese with them. So it was I still don't. I speak a very poor Portuguese. I made myself understood. Now, my last tour there, I didn't do much teaching, because we were closing out the home economics part, and we had people that had come to Purdue and gotten their master's. So they've gone to a few other schools. Some went to Cornell, some to Ohio State, some to Iowa and Missouri, but most of them came to Purdue. And so we had teachers that had their master's and were well prepared to teach. Mm-hmm. And so we were bringing more Purdue families there, and we were working out in what we would call here regional campuses, the dairy farm and the horticulture farms that were away from the campus. We were bringing home Purdue people there. So I had the pleasure of traveling and buying furniture, furnishing houses, and training. Well, my driver would help find the maid service and the gardeners, and then I would help train them in the ways that their new employers would want them to perform, and help them understand the strange ways of the Americans, and try to break the ground for the new families that were coming. Then we would go to Rio and meet them, take them through customs and through the embassy procedures, and take them out to Viçosa, which sometimes would take 2 days, according to the weather, how muddy the roads were, and how much we had to lay over someplace until the roads were fit to travel.
What, that's sort of in the interior of the country.
Very much.
Is the university still goes?
Oh, yes. Yeah, they now, the roads are much improved, and the agriculture is much improved, and the forestry and so forth, and they now have a veterinary school, and they give their own bachelor's, master's, and PhDs, so they're very much on their own. They still invite us back, and we invite them up here, but it's a much, much different place. The university is... It's just unbelievable.
It's grown physically, the physical plant.
Yes, uh-huh.
The students that were there when you were there, where did they come? Did they come from where?
From all over the country.
Country?
Okay. Uh-huh. All over.
What was the school?
All over South America, because it was the only home economics school in existence. And we helped, and I helped to do that, too, in the southern part of Brazil. And Rio Grande do Sul, we helped develop a home economics department in a university, and we helped Ohio State and Purdue together help develop a home economics department at São Paulo, very, very progressive university.
Nice contacts. Do you still keep in touch with some of the...
Oh, yes, yes.
Have you visited there?
Some of my very, very best friends are Brazilians.
What was it like living there? Did you live on the campus? Did you have an apartment?
Well, it's a very different living situation. In Brazil, professors live in what they call the professor's villa. University has their own housing, and we live in the professor's villa.
Were these apartments?
Yes. Well, houses.
Houses?
Yes, because you had whole families. Whole families.
So you had a house to yourself?
Yes. Uh-huh, yes.
How far it's...
But now, sometimes the home economists would share a house, but it would be a double house, and so it was really separated, but it would be...
What was student life there like? Were there activities?
Soccer. Puchy ball. And they had a... recreational center where they had a pool and various kinds of
Did they interact? Were there clubs or anything of that sort?
Not as much as we have here, and as much as they have now because of all the American influence.
Mm-hmm. It was a smaller...
Yeah, because, see, the students would come to the United States to study, and they discover how... Of course, that's how the whole process started, was professors in agriculture would come to the United States, and they discovered Purdue and Ohio State and Cornell and some of the other land-grant colleges, and just Purdue was the one that made the contract with USAID and the Brazilian government and got the... Mm-hmm. School started in...
Were there other schools in agriculture and home economics that were involved in this program, or was it just those two? Were there the sciences at all involved?
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
So they also went down to...
Oh, yes, your chemistry professors. This is a strong chemistry program when I was there. Uh-huh.
Did you get the chance to travel around the country when you were there?
I didn't travel as much as a lot of the families did, just mainly because I wanted to be with Brazilians and I really wasn't there as a tourist. And so I spent more of my time with my the professors and their families there in the villa. And of course there were many Brazilian families that are in the villa as well as the American families. And my traveling was like when I went to Rio Grande do Sul for almost a semester to help develop that school, or home management department. And then, of course, when you travel as a Purdue home economist down there, you would, you know, if the foods and nutrition department needed some help, whether that was your major emphasis or not, you work with those professors.
Sure.
We work, you know, across the board, but my main object was developing the home management program. And then in addition, we would have professors that wanted us to help them start high schools. They did not have high school home economics either, of course. And so I did that around in the state of Minas Gerais. I worked with about three different high schools in helping them set up programs.
In that general area there?
Yes.
Or Minas Gerais is close to Azusa?
Yes. Yeah. Well, it would be like if I would go and set up a high school from Lafayette, go to Kokomo or down to Crawfordsville. You know, about that distance, of course, the distance of farmers' travel was farther. But it was, some of my very best friends are people I've worked with in Brazil.
That's nice. And you've kept in touch?
Oh, yes. Yeah they come here, yeah. They visit, they're friends of my family, and they visit my family in Connersville. And particularly the girls that have come back to get their PhDs here. Those are probably my closest friends. For instance, one of my very best friends there calls my family her foster family, and you know, playing on the words foster, knowing what it means in English, and that being their name. I think my family keeps up with her probably and keeps contact with her as much or more than I do.
Than I do.
Uh-huh.
That's nice. Yes. It was a nice experience.
I loved it. I didn't want to come home. But I didn't want to lose my citizenship. I still had...
Were you able to come back to the States in the meantime during your contract?
I came back for one summer. Went to conventions on the West Coast and I traveled practically the whole summer I was here because I was, gathering information and recruits and doing some kinds of work for the university to, spread the word that they have good students there, that they make good graduate students. And,
right.
You know.
Doing a little field work.
Oh, yes. And so that was... Then I had to go back early because I had a new family coming in to go out to one of these satellite schools that I knew they needed my driver, Jose, and me to usher them around. And so I cut my visit short. And then at the end, when I was, leaving for good, they let me set the date that I was going to leave. And I went just as far as I could go, and then I forgot there were 31 days in October, so I came home on October the 30th. I was very disgusted that I cheated myself one day in Brazil.
You won't do that again, right?
Right.
Okay. A couple things. Is there any memorable event in your life that you'd like to, that you recall when you're reminiscing?
Oh, my. There's so many of them that have been thinking about these interviews, and I keep thinking of things that I hadn't thought of for a long time. Then I would think, well, did that happen when I was an undergraduate or a graduate student? And I'd get the records out and check, and then in doing that, I'd think, oh, I'd forgotten about that, you know.
This is your chance.
And I probably can't recall any of those things right now when I want to. I think probably seeing the changes later, not while they were going on. For instance, when I was an undergraduate, we could not walk across the Memorial Mall from what is now Stone Hall, from Matthews Hall, over to Stewart Center area. Well, it wasn't Stewart Center, that was the Union, because you could not walk on that green oval. That was for ROTC drill and exhibitions for putting the wreath on John Purdue's grave and Gale Week and things like that. You would be fined, and it would be a $5 fine. And at that time, you know, you maybe bought two books for $5. $5 was a stiff fine. And so when they started putting the sidewalks across the mall, every time I walk across there, I think what it would be costing me. And then now, you know, students can't imagine not being able to walk across there. Well, we had to all walk. We had to, around the oval, we could walk around. And that's how Hello Walk started. It was not where it is now, you know.
Around from State Street it would come in.
Yeah, that's right. Around in front of Stanley Corder Hall.
And then over to the University Hall.
Yeah, that's right.
Any other tradition? That's very interesting. I had not heard that.
Yeah, that, and of course dress is one thing. Like going to the music hall. Well, I better back up because the music hall wasn't built except until it was being built while I was an undergraduate, and of course Fowler Hall was the large meeting place as well as areas in the Vermont Union. But the things like that, the football stadium was not there. It played football in between what is now Elliott and the Armory. That was the football field. And, you know, and then as things like that changed, you don't think about it while you're there as a change is going on. But then as time goes on, you think how different it is. I'm sure that will continue to be that way.
Changes
everywhere.
Right, yeah. Are there any questions that I failed to ask that you want to raise?
No.
Or any topics you want to return to?
I can't think of any at the time.
But overall, I
probably pretty much rambled on and on.
No, I think that you did really.
Because as I think of things, and I always have to back it up with a preface because it doesn't, you know, you can't start in the middle of things. So I've been here so long.
We talked earlier about Chauncey Village, but I think one thing that I would like, how has Lafayette changed since you've been here?
Oh, you mean Lafayette?
Yeah, Lafayette.
Oh, well, of course.
That kind of will work
from,
in with Chauncey.
From the village down the hill and over across the river, that has, you know, changed completely. There wasn't anything there except floodland and...
No buildings?
No.
At the foot of State Street and the River Road?
No, not until Bruno's was built. That was the first building down there I can remember.
Wow.
And
were there any gas stations?
Yeah, oh yes.
Sure.
But gas stations everywhere that they aren't now, you know. I wonder with all the cars we have now around, There's not many gas stations as there used to be. Yeah.
There was the one there, right near Cranard. I used to use it. Bill Davis had that one there, right across from the bookstore.
Yes, where Ross Hall is.
Right. Bill Davis had that.
Yes, the village has changed, and then, as you say, across in Lafayette, of course, We go to the mall now. We used to go downtown, down to downtown Lafayette to the courthouse. Stores around the courthouse, department stores, and jewelry stores, and gift shops. And
downtown has really changed in some extent because there really aren't a lot of those facilities there anymore.
No.
You have to go to the mall.
You have to go to the mall somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The Walmart or someplace.
Right.
Which the kind. Well, and the other thing has changed a lot are the availability of grocery stores. That's still, I think, I can't understand why there we need more grocery facilities close to where the students are living, because they're not everybody has access to the vehicle, and buses are all right, but buses are not good for grocery shopping.
That's right. Exactly.
And that is a great. There were, of course, grocery stores in the village, and then down as the bill, after the levee built up, and we had some businesses down there. We had Smitty's grocery down there, you know. It's very difficult for people without cars and needing groceries.
Okay. Any closing remarks or comments for the researchers that are going to be able to share with us?
I've thoroughly enjoyed this, and I think I like the idea of Purdue putting more emphasis on the history of the university, and I think this will spur me on to go on and develop the files and the memorabilia labeling and so forth that I have, and get it into the archives to commemorate a little bit more of what Home Management House was and some of the other things that
they're key to the development and growth of the school.
Oh, definitely.
Right. Good. Thank you very much. This concludes the interview.